Okay.
Okay,
6 o'clock. Boker Tov. Thank you. Okay, let's we'll get started. I think, Rabbi, I assume you'll share your sources. We do have the two source sheets you were talking about last week are posted on the website. I can post them in the chat box, but I don't know which one you want to use when, but I'll let you manage that. Okay.
You'll see now very soon why I didn't do this last week, because it's complicated. So I'm going to begin with the review. And the official title this week is to understand why the year is 5781 in light of our study. But before we get to all that and that big topic, let's do a quick little review. I'll share my screen and we can start the recording. You started the recording. Okay. Where's my screen? Here we go. Class number 5, I think we're up to. The confusion, we'll see about nearly 70 years and we'll see. Okay. What did we do last week? Last week, we studied the first 6 chapters of Ezra. And they begin with the first year of Koresh and the famous Cyrus Declaration, the title of our course. And it went to the second year of when they returned and they break ground on the second temple. And they try to get off the ground. They have an altar and they bring sacrifices, but the temple was built yet. But within a couple months of breaking ground on their temple, we call it the First Intifada, and the building is stopped. Now, we also noticed, when we did that, there was a break. There was a gap between year 2 of Koresh until year 2 of Daryavesh. Prove that from the book of Zechariah and Haggai. And we notice also that from Zechariah, I think we quoted that pasuk, that the second year of Daryavesh was 70 years from the time the temple was destroyed. Now, and that helped us calculate the different sets of 70 years, meaning there was a set of 7 years beginning with the first year of Bavel, which ended with the Cyrus Declaration. And there's 70 years in hindsight that Zechariah is talking about from the temple being destroyed in the 11th year of Zedekiah until the second year of Daryavesh. Now, if you want to count how many years were in between, year 4 of Jehoiakim, which is the first year of Bavel, minus 605, there were 7 years left of Jehoiakim's reign. And the last year of Jehoiakim's reign was when Jehoiakim goes into exile. And then Zedekiah was king for 11 years. So there's a total of 18 years. There's an 18-year gap between the two sets of 70 years. So if there's 18 years between the first year of Bavel, fourth year of Jehoiakim, and the 11th year of Zedekiah, then there has to be 18 years between the second year of Koresh and the second year of Daryavesh. That's nice and simple. Or from the first year of Koresh to the second year of Daryavesh. Then we talked about the different reasons why it's time to build. We had the reasons why people didn't come back. We explained why the big question is, year 2 of Daryavesh is like the biggest date in Haggai and Zechariah. That's when they finally do break ground on the temple. Why is there so much energy to build in the second year of Daryavesh? One could be because the 70 years are finally over, according to all the opinions that we talked about. Now, for sure, 70 years are over. Also, the new administration, new king of Persia, Darius the Great takes over. According to Chazal, that's Ahasuerus' son. And we're going to talk about all this, the plethora of prophecy in Haggai and Zechariah. There's something big going on that we have to discuss already next week's year. And the underlying question between all of this is redemption something in the stars? Meaning, is it 7 years of exile, 7 years are over, it's time to build, we have to make sure we're counting right? Or is it up to man? God can promise a lot of things, but nothing happens unless we do our part. And that's the question, how much is redemption a two-way street? Do we sit back, God, and have God do everything for us? Or do we have to take initiative? If you want to take a modern day analogy, when there's a crisis like Corona, it's the government's job to solve all of our problems. We sit back and do nothing, and the government has to solve all of our problems. Or can the government give a framework and the people, citizens, have to do their part? If I want to give a little muster for these first Israelis. Now we'll get to the complicated part. I want to do a quick review of what we just did about these 70 years to make it clear. I told you I hope this will clarify what we talked about last week. I have a table here comparing Yirmiyahu 70 years to Zechariah 70 years. Now again, Zechariah is making a statement. He's not making a prediction. Zechariah is stating in the second year of Daryavesh, he's praying, says, God, have mercy on us. It's been 70 years since the temple was destroyed. That's a statement of fact. That's not a prediction. Therefore, that tells us from the 11th year of Zedekiah to the second year of Daryavesh is exactly 70 years. Or if I look in this, if I look at my table over here, The temple is destroyed here in the year of Ibn Sidkil. From here until the second year of Dayavash is 18 years of Persian rule. That's 18 years over there. Now, Yirmiyahu makes the prediction that the Babylonians will be in power for 70 years. Do we start counting from the first year of Nebuchadnezzar's reign, year one of Nebuchadnezzar, number 605 BCE, which is the fourth year of Jehoiakim? 7 years later, Jehoiakim is exiled, which is year 11 of Jehoiakim. 11 years later, the temple is destroyed, year 11 of Sidkiel, and these are the sources for all the Psukim. The Seder's declaration is 70 years after Nebuchadnezzar's reign began, give or take a little bit. Then this we'll deal with later on when we get to Achashverosh. In other words, if I follow the years of Megillat Esther, the big party is year three of Koresh, the third year of Achashverosh's reign begins in the third of Koresh. The big party is year six, which is almost 69 years from the first wave of exile. We'll do this properly. We have the Purim miracle, and Darius succeeds Achashverosh, and sure enough, their kid, 6 years, a couple years later, is going to be the next year. Is this the second year of Dayavash? Again, this we'll return to later on. That was just to show you the 17 years in the table, maybe the 18 years in the table. Now, let's review what we did in this year. My whole point was the book of Ezra has intentional gaps. What are they? From year one of Koresh to year two of Dariabesh is gap one. From the return of the exiles until the second, we don't know who is the king in between. We're never told how many years Koresh is king for. Who is the king, if there was a king between Koresh and Dariabesh, we don't know. Now, the rabbis try to explain it. Seder Olam claims that the king in between is Achashverosh. According to outside history, we'll see, it's a king named Cambyses. How to correlate between them? We'll spend time on that later on. The main point we made at the end of this year was, in year six of Dariavesh, when they finished building the temple, remember they began in year two, they broke ground, year six, they finished the work on the temple. When that's over, they make a Chanukah, they dedicate it. They make a big Passover in Nisan that year. And then dead silence. Nothing happens between chapter 6 and chapter 7 in the book of Ezra. What's really cute, just to remember that, sometimes it's confusing. Year 6 is chapter 6 in Ezra. Year 6 of Dayavesh is chapter 6 in Ezra. Chapter 7 in Ezra is the 7th year of Artaxerxes. That's a different king. And therefore, from Ezra chapter 6, verse 14, to 7:7, what do you call it? It was, we have this gap in between again, the end of chapter 6 and beginning of chapter 7. In classic history, that's when Megillat Esther takes place. We'll dedicate a whole share to that later on. What's amazing is Seder Olam claims there is no gap. And what we're going to see today, and hope this is clear, this gap between year 6 of Dariavesh and year 7 of Artaxerxes, according to Chazal, there is no gap. How could there be no gap? Well, Chazal claim it's the next year, but how can we go from year 6 of Dayavesh to year 7 of Artaxerxes if there's no gap in between? What do they claim? That Dayavesh is Artaxerxes. They say it's simply the same king. And when does Ezra make Aliyah? As soon as the Mikdash is completed, Ezra makes Aliyah. It works out so nice. Now, we're going to see, if we have time, we'll see it today, why that doesn't make sense according to the book of Ezra. In other words, there are too many things happening from chapter 7, 8, 9, and 10 of Ezra, the end of the book of Ezra, that seem to be much later. When you read the book logically, when Ezra makes Aliyah, it doesn't seem like it's the year after 6 of Dariavesh. So it doesn't make sense in the book of Ezra itself. For sure, when you compare the names of these kings to outside sources, for sure it doesn't make sense. But for some reason, Chazal claim there is no gap, and what they say, Hu Dayavesh or Artaxerxes, it's the same king. The first part of the shir today, I want to explain why they say that. Just going over the events, then year 20 will be Nehemiah's Aliyah, that book Nehemiah. The last years in Nehemiah, years 32 and 34. And from a technical point of view, the last event in Tanakh, the last historical event in Tanakh that's recorded with a date, is the last chapter of Nehemiah, year 34 of Artaxerxes, when Nehemiah returns to Israel and does a couple more reforms. That's the last historical event. And we have another gap later on, we'll see, between the end of Tanakh and Greek history. That happens later on. The first part of the show we want to do today is try to understand what happens to gap two. as far as gap one's concerned, remember? Gap one, we did a calculation. Gap one is 18 years. Make it nice and big here. I think a little two-year-old there. Gap one is 18 years. What happened during those 18 years? We'll have a share on that. Is that the story of Big Gilat Esther or not? A lot of fun with that. But we know for sure that gap one is exactly 18 years. That's that you can calculate by comparing Yirmiyahu 70 years and Sari 70 years. You can calculate that. That matches outside history as well. Who's the king in between? Big argument. Gap two, yeah, that was last week's year in the beginning of this week. Gap two, what happens between Daryavesh and Artaxasta is the goal of this week's year. Now, I want to begin with a quick proof why Pshat can't be the next year. Real simple. Who are the key characters in the first 6 years in the first six chapters of the book of Ezra? It's not Ezra. Ezra's not mentioned. Zerubbabel is a political leader, mentioned over and over again. Yehoshua ben Yatzadok, the high priest, the chief rabbi. Haggai and Zechariah are the Nevim. Haggai gives all his nevuot in year two of Daryavesh. Zechariah, year two and year four of Daryavesh. And that's it. No nevuot anytime later on. And no Nevim later on. That's the end of Nevim that are recorded. It could be Malachi was later. We don't have a date stamp for Malachi. But the last recorded dates where there's a nevuah are year two and year six of Daryavesh. And who are the key characters? Again, their political leaders are Haggai. I mean, their prophetic leaders are Haggai and Zechariah, political leaders, Zerubbabel and Yehoshua ben Yesedon. When Ezra makes Aliyah in chapter seven, he doesn't meet any of them. Now, the most important thing to remember is there was an intifada during those 18 years. And the local population were fighting with us. They didn't get along. The Jewish people arrived, did not get along with the local population. When Ezra makes Aliyah, I'll just give you an example real quick. We'll stop this share. I'm going to open up the book of Ezra. If you have it not with you, open up chapter 7 in the book of Ezra. I'll share my screen. And we'll get a Tanakh open. Let's get to the book of Ezra. In chapter 7, he makes Aliyah. Okay, we have a whole list of people who makes Aliyah with them. We talked about that. And then chapter 8, what happens? He finally arrives. Here. I'll read from the beginning. Oh, I'm sorry, that's Nehemiah. Chapter 8 in Ezra. Okay. Chapter 8, you can get another list of all the people coming. He brings the people and he gets all the money together. Okay, you can skip chapter 8. Chapter 9. Here we go. Chapter 9. After he arrives, gives all the money, all the donations he brought with him. Nikshu elai hasarim lemor. Okay. The leaders of the people, they accept Ezra with open arms. It's great. Okay. Ezra's coming to do the reform, to teach Torah. And when he presents all the money and everything he brings and arrives and they welcome him, all the leaders come to him and say what? Lo nivdulu ha'am Yisrael v'akonim ha'levim mi'amei ha'aretzot. Ketuvatem l'knani ha'chiti ha'prizi ha'ivusi ha'vamni ha'vamavi mitzi ba'amori. What's happening? Everyone's assimilated and intermarried. Why? Ki nasu b'imnotem lehem v'divneem v'itarvu zer ha'kodesh b'amei ha'aretzot. When Ezra arrives, he finds mass intermarriage. See that? That's black on white. Now, the intermarriage he's talking about in assimilation is talking about their children intermarried and Zera Kodesh, like Jewish seed, mixed with non-Jewish seed. And the leaders are involved in this as well. To say that all that happened during those 18 years, that's difficult. The fact that in year two to year six of Daryavesh, they build the temple and they finish the temple against the local population. And the next year, Ezra arrives and doesn't find Haggai and Zechariah at all. And everyone, all the leaders who are there, we don't know their names yet, but they're not Haggai and Zechariah for sure. And they're not Yeshua and Zerubbabel. But the leaders who are there tell Ezra, Rabbi, you're wasting your time. Everyone's intermarried. They're all assimilated. You're teaching them a ksos, and then what do you call it? They don't know all of it. And what does he do? He rips his clothes And then people come to him. Everyone who was a couple people came in. What do you call it? They have a big fast and he davens and he's so embarrassed. We'll read this later on. But Ezra in his prayer, what's he saying? God told us, you know, don't give your children to their sons and do that. Okay. And then what's going on? And therefore, what's he saying? Hashem Elokei Yisrael, Tzadik Atay Ki Nishanu Pleita Kayom Azeh Hinu Lefenecha Bashvotenu Ki Ein Lamod Lefenecha Azot. So Ezra prays to God. He says, forgive us for all this. He's asking God to give us a new start. Just one more line in Perek 10, in Perek Yud. U'kitpaleu Ezra kitpado bochem mitpadim pelifnei Hashem yikapsu elvi Yisrael kal rav. Oh, he's crying so much, he gets a whole big gathering, women and children. And then this is the greatest guy. Shchanya ben Yechiel. One of the people listening from an Elamite that's from Persia, he tells Ezra, you know what, Rabbi, anachnu ma'anu me'elohinu. You're right, we did wrong to God. But no shed nashim achriel, we took foreign wives from Namei Haaretz. But there's hope. What do we do? Atan nichrod brit le'elohinu. Lotziko nashim v'nolad mehem batzat Adonai, v'acharidim b'yisad halinu v'chator yaseh. We say, you know what, Rabbi? We're going to dump all the foreign wives. Get rid of them and their kids. A whole new start. He says, King Kol Lecha Davar. He says, get up. You can do it, Rabbi. But Nachman, and we're with you, Rabbi. Chazak Vaseh. Shchanani takes a, what do you call it? You know, takes the initiative. We're going to get rid of all the foreign wives. Ezra gets up and he makes everyone swear. Okay. And Ezra gets up in front of God's house. Okay. Remember, when Ezra comes out, the temple is built. People would say Ezra built the second temple, so we haven't read Tanakh. Zerubbabel builds it. And they make a rule, everyone's come to Yerushalayim. Everyone comes together, and we have to just read one line because it's so classic. Okay. Ezra gives a big speech, get rid of the foreign wives, and everyone says, Rabbi, you're right. But this is the great, what's called Aval, but, big but, what is it? Avala Amrav. Hey, there's a lot of people here. The eight kshamim. Hey, it's raining outside, like today. Vein kmach lamod b'chutz. We can't say, no. We agreed to get rid of our, but we have to do it properly. We don't have time for this. V'amlecha lo liyom echad lo l'shnayim. It's not, we can't do this in a day or two. Kibanu l'bshov, because there's too many things we have to do. Let's bury it in a committee. You know what it means to bury something in a committee? Yamduna sarenu l'cho akal l'cho asher barenu. Let our leaders in every community, right, in all of our cities, Hoshiv Nashim Nachriot Yavod Litim Zumanim. Let's invite the people one by one to come to the committee with all their papers, whoever took a foreign wife. Bimemzi, and let the elders of every city come along with them and the judges. Ad Lashiv Charon Afashem Hin Menu Ad Ladavarze. Got it? It's called to bury something in the committee. Let me just stop here for a minute. All I'm trying to show you is that when you read the book, when Ezra comes, what he finds does not fit to be the year after they dedicated the second temple. If you read the dedication ceremony of the second temple, from year two to year six of Dayavish building, and the local, and who the leaders were, and who the local population was, how they didn't get along, and all of a sudden, say the next year after they dedicate the temple, within a year's time, everyone's intermarried. Haggai and Zechariah are gone. Yeshua and Zerubbabel are gone. We'll see we have the grandchildren later on. To say that happens within a year just doesn't make sense. Despite that, now on top of that, when we look at the outside sources, we'll see there's kings with all these different names. We know who Daryavish was, and we know there's a king named Artaxasta. There's kings in between. It makes so much more sense that Ezra came about 40, 50 years later when it's typical we have third generation assimilation. What I want to do today is try to understand why the Seder Olam and the prominent opinion in Chazal, why are they so adamant to say that there's no gap? What leads them to that? Now, what enables that, what enables saying there's no gap is the fact that there is nothing recorded in that gap. Now, Sefer Ezra, what I claim, purposely has a gap between year six of Dayavesh and year seven of Artaxasta for a thematic reason. Why? Because when nothing happened, nothing's recorded. When the Jewish people do nothing to build up Yerushalayim, in the book of Ezra, we don't record anything. Because the topic of Ezra Nehemiah is all the efforts done to rebuild Yerushalayim and the Mikdash. when nothing happens, nothing's recorded. It's like when you want to punish a child, you ignore him. Any years that were not, that nothing happened in relation to the Mikdash are simply skipped over. That's what happens over and over again in the book of Ezra. Why? We have to go back and discuss that. What I want to do now, I want to understand, what did the rabbis gain by cutting out the years, by hiding the years? So now, take a break, and we're going to play a game. Not play a game. We have to discuss something first. I want to talk about calendars. Let me give a open up a different screen here. Okay. First, just list of kings real fast. If you look in any outside source, any history book, there's a king named Cyrus or Koresh. There's a king named Cambyses. These are the years. There's Darius the Great. There's a king named Xerxes. A king named Artaxerxes. If you match up Tanakh, they match up perfect, don't they? Koresh is Cyrus. Cyrus is Koresh. Cambyses is who seems to be Artaxerxes in the letters, which we have to go back and do in chapters 4, 5, and 6. Daryavish is Darius, and Ahasuerus should be Xerxes, and Artaxerxes will be Artaxerxes. Meaning, if I look at outside history in the years, it matches Tanakh perfectly. It's a perfect match. The other stuff we'll get to later on. But for some reason, the rabbis are going to crunch all those years. They're going to put Ahasuerus earlier and say that Daryavish Artaxerxes is the same king. Now, before we discuss why, I want to what I call clarify concepts. Right? The Jewish calendar, is it a tool or truth? I'll explain what I mean in a minute. Let me hide this for a minute. I need a little participation. Why do people need calendars? Because we need a 24-hour day to plan our days, right? You need months. Based on the moon, months are very helpful, even weeks. But why do we need to count years? If you just think regular, why is there a need to know what year it is? Anyone want to give a reason? Why does, forget Judaism, why does every society need to know what year it is?
Contracts.
Business. Economics.
Yeah. When for economics and contracts, in fact, if you know Masechet Sanhedrin, what's necessary for a star to be kosher? You need to have, it has to have signatures, it has to have a time and a date. The date has to include the day of the month, and the year. Got it? I can live without the day of the week, but the year is critical. And again, before we get to like knowing your history and things like that, everyone needs to know dates. Like you're renting something for a year. You're renting a house. You're renting a field. Now, in addition to that, the agricultural calendar, which is also economics, is important. Exactly, planting the agricultural year. People, every society needed to count years. How did you count a year? We talked about that maybe before, but you can either go, just like in a day, I can start from sunrise or sunset. In a solar year, I can begin with the winter solstice. I can begin with the summer solstice. I can begin with the spring equinox or the fall equinox. I can begin with the seasons. But there's a clear marker when a year begins and a year ends. I can decide I want to start in the spring or the fall or the winter. I can easily pick and I have to increment a year every year. That's for sure. But what do I count to? Now, we're so used to counting up, you know, every year, another year, 2005, 2006, 2007. We do that. In ancient times, no one did that. No one counted from year. There was no year zero. Everyone counted to kings. In every outside source, before the Greeks, everyone had calendars. Everyone had months and seasons and holidays. But years were always counted to the king, be it King Charles or King George or King Henry or King, everyone counted to years. And that's why to know contracts, not only do you know what year it is, you need to know a list of kings. Because if I signed a contract in year two of Koresh, and now it's year five of Daryavish, I need to know how many kings, how many years Koresh reigned for, and who was the king in between, who was the king after that. That's why we find so many lists of kings in ancient archaeology. And people had to memorize lists of kings. It was like they were well known. And for the sake of calendars, there were always lists of kings. Now, the Greeks were the first people to start counting from year one and increment every year and not stop. That's called, there'll be a concept called, the rabbis called Minyan Shtarot, which is the counting for shtarot or documents. But that, in essence, is the Greek year, the Seleucid year. Alexander the Great, of course, he was one of the greatest conquerors of all. His kingdom didn't last very long because he died soon after he conquered everything, after he conquered and defeated the Persians. There was a fight over succession. In 312 BCE, there was a council after the Battle of Gaza that they decided instead of one person taking over the Greek Empire, they divided the Greek Empire into three parts. Remember that? Ptolemy in Egypt, the Seleucids in Syria, and back in Greece itself, I think Demetrius, or I forgot this guy's name. But they divided the Greek Empire into three parts, and they decided this is year one. And we're no longer going to go and remember dates and kings and things like that, because we have Hellenism, the Greek Empire. There's lots of different emperors in different areas. It's so big. From now on, year one and year two, and we're going to increment every year. That was a chiddush that no one ever thought of doing before. The Greeks were able to do it because they were very advanced and they had a massive empire. The Persians didn't do it. The Persians had lists of kings. And the Babylonians didn't do it. They counted to their kings. The Greek year begins, and it continued even after the Greeks fell apart and the Romans took over. The Romans continued the Greek year. Now, if I'm using a year, the year system that we're using has to be viral. You understand why it needs to be viral? Because it's got to be something everyone's using. It's the more every. Why do we use 2020 or 20? How can we use the non-Jewish date? We don't believe it's their Lord at that. Because everyone else is using it. It's a standard, it's a convention. Because the more a year is a convention, the better it works. In the time of the rabbis, in the time of Chazal, the time of the Mishnah and Talmud, what year are the rabbis using? Anyone know? The rabbis have shtarot, don't they? In the time of the Talmud, you know what counting system they're using? No one's counting to creation. In the entire Bible, no one counts to creation. People don't realize that. You can read Tanakh from cover to cover. There's not one date to Briat Olam. Maybe I can calculate it, but no event. Shlomo becomes king, right? You know, there's kings, how many years? Instead from Melachim, we counted the years of the kings. But there's no counting in Chumash, we count to Yitzhak Mitzrayim, don't we? But no one counts to Briat Olam. No one counts to the flood. No one counts. We know what year the flood was, maybe. And we count the flood to the years of Noah, don't we? But no one keeps years of creation. It wasn't done. In the Mishnah, never. In the Talmud, never. Nothing is ever counted to creation. No one ever counted to creation. It's a much later custom that began. So what did the rabbis count to when they had shtarot? So during the Persian time period, they counted to the Persian king. What did the rabbis do? Remember, the Zugot. Pirkei Avot, or basically Torah Shavah Peh, the Mishnah, begins in Hellenistic times, doesn't it? Guess what year the rabbis used? Anyone want to give a wild guess? What years were the rabbis using? They used the Greek year. You know why? I joke because it was free. It wasn't because it was free, because everyone was using it. We use a Greek name for the Sanhedrin, don't we? There's tons of Greek culture coming in. There's nothing wrong with that, and there's nothing idol worship about it. It's the Greek year. It's a convention. We used the Persian years, didn't we? In the book of Haggai, in the book of Ezra, didn't we use the Persian years, the first year of Koresh, second year of Dayavesh? So now I use the Greek years because the Greeks are running the show. Now, if you know your Chazal, the temple was destroyed in year 380. Anyone ever hear that date? The Greek year 380 is the year the temple was destroyed. Just take that as a given. Now we're going to play a game. Let's say I don't want to use a Greek year. Let's say I want to use a Jewish year. What would be the most logical thing to count to? But then we could start from scratch. Let's say we're like Zionistic or, you know, super nationalistic, and we don't want a Greek year. We want a Jewish year. Give me ideas of what you could count from.
Yitzhak Mitzrayim.
Okay, Yitzhak Mitzrayim, but I could count to Matan Torah, Yitzhak Mitzrayim, Avram Avinu, Priyat Olam, Flood, etc. Now, in Chumash, what do we count to in Chumash? Do we ever count Yitzhak Mitzrayim and Chumash?
No.
Everywhere, don't we? But Parshat HaChodesh, we count months. Don't we count months to Yitzhak Mitzrayim? We don't count entering the land. We count Yitzhak Mitzrayim. I'll give you some examples. Look how the book of Bamidbar begins. Let's go right to here. Sefer Bamidbar right here. First line of the book. The first line of Sefer Bamidbar is what? God spoke to Moshe, Birar Sinai, Becha, the Chodesh Hashanei, Beshana Hashanit, the Tzeitan Eretz Mitzrayim. Got it? Now, the book of Devarim, first line of the first, third line of the book. Here's what Moshe spoke. And it came to pass Arbaim Shana, on the 40th year from leaving Egypt. And all through Chumash, we count Yitzhak Mitzrayim. Got that? And no, nothing else. Yitzhak Mitzrayim, Matan Torah, it's the same year. Now, in the book of Yeshua, do we count years to anything? Is there any, in the book of Yeshua, is there any years to anything? Nothing at all. We know maybe how many years Yeshua lived for. We don't know what happened after Yeshua. There's no continuous chronology in the book of Yeshua or the book of Shoftim. The book of Shoftim, for sure, there's 40 years, 40 years, 40 years, and they all overlap. The authors of Sefer Yeshua and Shoftim and Shmuel make no effort to give you continuous chronology. In fact, try to figure out the chronology, you get all mixed up. But none of the books, and nothing's dated to anything. We don't date anything to anything. There's only one date in Tanakh that goes to Yitzhak Mitzrayim. Anyone know what that is?
And the Binyan Bayit. Binyan Bayit Rishon. Exactly.
And that's the anchor. That's the anchor of all biblical dating. Right? If I look in the book of Kings, Sefer Melachim, easy to remember. Sefer Melachim, Aleph, Perek Vav, chapter 6, right in front of us. And what a coincidence. Vahi. Bishmonim Shana Varbamot Shana. It's 480 years since we left Egypt. In the fourth year of Shlomo's reign, in the month of Ziv, which is the second month of Iyar, when Shlomo was king, and they built a house for God. That's our anchor for all biblical dating now. What do we know now? The fourth year of Shlomo is what? Is 480 Mitzrayim. Got it? And what a coincidence, 12 sets of 40 years. 12 times 40, 480. What a coincidence. But that's an anchor, 480, isn't it? Now, archaeologists don't like this year at all. It doesn't match up at all. If you want to put Ramses as the, in other words, David and Shlomo are about 1,000 BCE, and they want to put Yitzhak Mitzrayim around 1250, give or take a little bit. Now, in archaeology, they put from Yitzhak Mitzrayim, for those who believe it happened, they put Yitzhak Mitzrayim to Shlomo Melech, about 250, maybe no more than 300 years. Here we have 480. How to deal with that? We'll deal with that later on. But for Seder Olam, we'll see in a minute, 480, that's an anchor. But now I know it's been 480 since Yitzhak Mitzrayim. Let's say I want to continue counting Yitzhak Mitzrayim. Let's say I'm living in the time of the rabbis, okay? I want to play the game with you. What the rabbis did. Let's say I would rather count Yitzhak Mitzrayim. How am I going to do that? Well, now I have an anchor, because I know that Shlomo built the Mikdash in 480 Yitzhak Mitzrayim. Now, in Sefer Melachim, right, is there a continuous chronology? Yes or no?
It's by the kings.
It goes by the kings, but there's continuous chronology. I don't date anymore to Yitzhak Mitzrayim, but I know how many years Shlomo was king for. I know in what year of his king the next guy became king. And the next guy became king. And if I count up all the, there's 18, no, 20? No, 18, I forgot about kings. There's four, I'm pretty sure there's 18 kings, yeah. There's 18 or 19 kings in Sefer Melachim in all their years. If I count up all those years, I get to about 428. If I count up all the years from the time Shlomo builds the Mikdash until the 11th year of Tzidkiel, I get 428 years. But the first year of every king is the last year of the previous king. So for every change of kings, I have to take off a year. Does that make sense?
Meaning, you don't count Rosh Chodesh Elul or something kings?
No. We increment the year. A king can become king on the 20th day of Adar, And 3 days later, on the second day of Nisan, is the second year of his reign.
No,
you understand the system? The system is simple. Okay? The system begins like this. The system begins with that's the Mishnah in Rosh Hashanah. We increment the years of the king on the first day of spring. That's just to keep, because now we can't remember everyone's birthday or every day's coronation day. So whatever year the king became king in, that's the first year of his reign. Rosh Chodesh Nisan, his first Rosh Chodesh Nisan is already the second year of his kingdom. So in theory, it could be the second year of his reign after 3 days, even after 2 days. If he was coronated on the last day of Adar, the next day it's the second year of his reign on Rosh Chodesh Nisan. Therefore, if Chizkiyahu is 28 years and Menashe is like 55 years, I have to take off a year from between them. And that's how I total things up. That's why Chazal say that Bayit Rishon is 410. Who learned that Bayit Rishon was 410? I'm sure you all heard that.
Mm-hmm.
There's a Masorah in Chazal, Bayit Rishon, first temple is 410. Okay. Now, therefore, the 11th year of Tzidkiyahu is what year? Now you're going to start smiling. I want you to do the math in your head. I'm going to open up a board. I'll pretend that I'm in a classroom and I need to share screen. Okay. And here's their screen and get a whiteboard. Here we go. Whiteboard and I can use text. Okay. I'm going to write this in. I have it in a table. I won't do it this way. If I'm counting to Yitzhak Mitzrayim, Yitzhak Mitzrayim. So 480 till Bayit Rishon. Okay. Bayit Rishon. Okay. Then I have 410 of Bayit Rishon. Got that? Now, which is what year? That's 11 Tzidkiyahu, isn't it?
Yeah.
Does that make sense? Nice and simple? We don't want that to happen. That's not good. That's not good. How do we make this bigger? Here we go. 11th year of Tzidkiyahu. Now, how many years is it from the 11th year of Tzidkiyahu until the second year of Dayavish? According to Zecharia. The 70th year of Korban. According to, that's Zechariah, chapter 1, verse 12. Why don't you see it one more time? Just to make sure I'm not making this up. We'll come back in a minute. I don't want to lose the screen, though. I think I won't lose it. I hope I won't lose it. No, I'll just save it, just in case. Here we go. Save it, in case I can't come back to it. I want to stop my share and make sure you see this pasuk because it's key. We saw it last week, but I want to make sure you believe me. If I go to the book of Zechariah, I mean, it's black on white. Here's Zecharia. I want to show you how simple it is. Zecharia chapter 1. What year is it? Shnat Shnayim L'Dayavish. Got it? Verse 12. In other words, on the 24th day of 11th year of again, Shnat Shnayim L'Dayavish in verse 6. We're still in year 2 of Dayavish. He has a vision. V'yan malach Hashem v'yomer Hashem tzvot ad matat talot torachim et yushem et yuhari yudha asher z'amte zeh shivim shana. Got it? That means it's 70 years. Year 2 of Dariavish is 70 years since the 11th year of Tzidkiyahu. Crystal clear?
Mm-hmm.
Nothing to that's black and white. Nothing else. It's real simple. Let's go back to our blackboard. Our whiteboard. Back to our whiteboard. Is it still? It's still there. Good. Okay. We're back to here. And we go back to our text. Okay. So, okay, based on this, that for what year? 2 Dayavesh equals what? Is what year Tzitzit Mitzrayim? Do the quick calculation.
5, 6.
How many years is that? 480, 410, and 70. Somebody do the math for me?
1,000.
No, no. 960, right?
960.
Okay. Year 2 of Dayavesh is 960. Now I'm stuck. Why am I stuck? Because from year, no, I'm sorry. And now year 6 of Dayavesh, I'm sorry. Year 6 of Dayavesh is what? That's the last event we have. Dayavesh is 964, right? 964? Close enough 4 years later, maybe 965, close enough. But year 2 Dayavesh. Okay, but that's enough for now. But 2 Dayavesh is 960, it's enough for now. Now, let's go back now and find out what happens next. Who's the king after Dayavesh? Let's go back to our table. Let's go back to our source sheet. Where are we? Missing years and missing dates. Here we go. Okay. Where's my gaps? Here we go. Okay. Remember, from Dariavesh to Artakshasta, right? There's a gap. We have no idea how many years in between. If I'm only using Tanakh, I have no idea. If I claim there's no gap, if I claim that Dariavesh, let me do this right. Let me make him. If I claim Dariavesh and Artakshasta is the same king, or basically what I'm saying, I'm going from, if I'm saying they're the same king, okay? Then there is no gap. Got that? It makes sense? If I claim there's no gap here, bye-bye gap, no gap. It's it, gone. I'll erase it. No gap. You don't see anything there. There's no gap. What's the last year of Tanakh now? Year 34 of Artakshasta is the last year of Tanakh. Agreed? That's a date. That's the last chapter of Nehemiah, chapter 13. You can look at it later on. Let's go. All clear?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, we'll stop the share. Now, go back to our whiteboard. Ba-bam, whiteboard. One whiteboard coming up. Here we go, whiteboard. Okay. Year two of Dariavesh is 960. What's year, text. What's year 34 of Dariavesh then? No, I'm sorry, year 34 of, make this wider. Year 34 of Artakshasta, Shasta, whatever his name is, okay, equals year 34 of Dariavesh, right?
Mm-hmm.
Which equals what year?
994.
Okay?
92.
No, 34, 990.
That was the second of Dariavesh beforehand.
994, right?
No.
I've got 34 years, maybe 993.
It was the second year of Dariavesh.
Okay. Second year of Dariavesh. Okay, put it this way. The year after Tanakh is over, okay? I'll say Tanakh ends the next year, that's 993. Okay, I will say here the next year. Next year, Tanakh ends. Now, you know what the rabbis say now? And now Tanakh ends in 994 from Yitzhak Mitzrayim. Oh, what up? Now I have a new, now what I need to know. Everyone, did everyone follow that? It's as simple as could be. We have, this is a pasuk, isn't it? 480 to by Rishon. I mean, that's a pasuk, isn't it? Oh, I just got rid of that. And this is a pasuk. Let me mark. Here we go. Where's my marker? Here we go. Draw. Okay. This is a pasuk, isn't it? This is calculated from Sukkim. This is a pasuk. This is a pasuk. This is a big assumption based on who Dayavet is the same king. Therefore, Tanakh ends in 994. Now, I want to count Yitzhak Mitzrayim. What year is it? I have no idea, right? But if I knew how many years it was from the end of Tanakh until Minyan Shtarot, I'll be okay, right? Let me show you this. Let me explain this again. All I need to know now, let me look at gap, what happened to gap three. Stop, share, here, share. All I need to know now, gap three, how many years is there from the end of Tanakh to the Greek year starts in 312. Make sense? Out of nowhere, where the rabbis come and say? Guess how many years it was? 6 years. The rabbis make this bold assumption that from the last year of Tanakh, right here, from year 34 of Nachatzah, which is the last year of Nehemiah, until the Greek year begins in 312 BCE, how many years elapsed? 6 years. 6 years happen. That's it. And 6 years later is Minyan Shtarot. That's all they claim. Nice and simple. It could be just by chance that happened, or it could be that's what they want to happen. Why? Why would that be great? Think for a minute. If Minyan Shtarot began 6 years after Tanakh is over, what year does Minyan Shtarot begin?
It's 1,000 years. It's been 1,000 years.
It's 1,000 since he set me throne. Isn't that elegant?
Yeah.
Follow? Now, if I can calculate, all I need to do is say there's no gap. I make two bold assumptions. One is that there's no gap between chapter 6 and 7 of the book of Ezra, between year six of Artaxerxes and seven of year six of Dayavish to seven of Artaxerxes. Remember I told you last week why I had to do that and why it was so complicated, but why it's so important? If I assume there's no gap between chapter six and seven of Ezra, even though it makes no sense in Pshat, but let's say there is no gap, then Tanakh ends in year 994, Tzitzit Mitzrayim. If I claim that Minyan Shro begins 6 years later, then when does the Greek year begin? In year 1000, Tzitzit Mitzrayim. If that's true, or if that's accepted, then when I use the Greek year, what am I using in essence?
1,000 years from Tzitzit Mitzrayim.
I'm using the Jewish year. What I need to do? Cross my fingers and add 1K. Understand? The Greek year became the Jewish year.
Is that where they get the...
Let me explain how I understand what the rabbis did. I think it's elegant what the rabbis did, and it's beautiful. It's got nothing to do with real history, but it's beautiful. During the Second Temple period, under Greek rule, which is most of the Second Temple period, and under Roman rule, the entire civilized world, all Hellenism and all the Roman Empire, is using the Greek year. That's what we're using. We'd much rather use the Jewish year. We don't have a Jewish king. Got nothing, right? We're nothing. But wouldn't it be great if we could use a Jewish year? What's the best Jewish year to use? Yitzhak Mitzrayim, that's what Chumash uses, right? Now, if I say this, then what happens? Once I accept that, then when I write the Greek year, all I need to do is what?
Add 1,000.
Got it? And I have the Jewish year. And we'll see the Gemara in Avodah Zarah. We'll probably see it next week, and maybe I'll show you quickly. What's the Gemara say? What is this? Well, there was a custom among the Sofrim that to the Greek year, they always added alpha. You know what alpha means? Alpha is 1K. In other words, there was a custom among scribes in the Second Temple period. When they wrote a shtar, they wrote the Greek year plus alpha. What do we do in Hebrew? What year is it? This year is not Tavshin Ayin Aleph. What is it? It's Hey Tavshin Ayin Aleph. But no one counts the thousands. We drop them. We're just counting within the hundreds, don't we? Mm-hmm. In English, we have 57 with numbers, but we use the Jewish, like Tavshin, Ayin. We drop the hay, don't we? We drop the thousands, we just go by the hundreds. But if that's true, what do the rabbis do? It makes so much sense the rabbis would do that. The rabbis wanted the Greek year to be the Jewish year. How did they do that? They added 1,000. Now, in order to do that, what do you have to say? I have to say there's no gap between Koresh and Dariavish. Understand? Maybe between Dariavish and Artaxerxes. That's one, but which makes no sense, but it's necessary. And I have to say there's 6 years between the end of Tanakh and Alexander the Great. None of those fit with Tanakh or outside history at all. They don't even begin. And I think when the rabbi said that, they never meant to be taken literally. But it's what's called Midrash. It's a beautiful Midrash of Seder Olam that turns the Greek date into a Jewish date. Got it? Now, want to see something that's a lot of fun? I hope you follow this. I'll do the calculation. I want to do it with you. I can give you the sheet. It's on the sheet, but I want to do it with you. What date is it today? Based on this, what day is Yitzhak Mitzrayim? So how can we figure that out? Let's work today. This right here. Let's go to text. Here we go. I'll put a text in. If Minyan Shtarot is what? 1,000 Yitzhak Mitzrayim. I'll write here Yitzhak Mitzrayim from YM from now on. Make sense? Now, what year is it today? What year is CE? Minyan Shtarot is minus 312 BCE. Make sense or not? Does that make sense? Minyan Shtarot, according to everyone, begins at minus 312. The Greek year. Minyan Shtarot is up right here, the Greek year. Minyan Shtarot equals Greek year. Equals 1,000 Yitzhak Mitzrayim. Therefore, what date is it now to Yitzhak Mitzrayim? What I have to do? Today is what? 20 plus 312 plus 1,000. Is that correct or not? Is that simple? Because today, Tzitzit Mitzrayim is what year? It's what? Do the, it's 33, 32. Is that right? They do the math right or not?
Yeah.
Everyone agree? According to this, if I follow Seder Olam, this year is 33, 32 Tzitzit Mitzrayim. Now, where did the Jews stop counting Tzitzit Mitzrayim? I'm sorry, to Binyan Shtarot. The Jews used Binyan Shtarot as long for, in Yemen, they're using it until 100 years ago, they were still using it. But the Jews in Europe, when did they stop using Binyan Shtarot? When the Goyim stopped using Binyan Shtarot. You understand? There's no point, if we don't use Binyan Shtarot because the Goyim are using it. Now, when we moved to Europe, in Europe, starting the 10th century or so, what's everyone using in Europe now? They're counting to their Lord. What they call AD, what we call CE, what they call AD. The year of Anadim, what it's called, Anadim or something like that.
Wait. We'll go together.
Yeah. They count their God. We can't do that, can we?
I need.
No.
The reason I'm going to ShopRite is because we get a free turkey.
Is that clear now? If I follow this whole logic, then this year, 2020, is 3332 Tzitzit Mitzrayim. Now, how many years is it from Briat Olam to Tzitzit Mitzrayim? That I hope you all know. Who knows? What year was up? Don't you know what year Tzitzit Mitzrayim was?
2448.
Yeah, what year was Avraham Avinu born?
1948.
That's what I call Yoshka Minator Minayim. So we understood it fine. Isn't it awesome that Avram was born in 1948 to Briat Olam? How do you calculate that? Yeah, I'll show you the table. Our whiteboard's being saved so we can stop this year. Let's go back to other share. Here we go. Here. Let's get 1948. Where are we? Here we go. Avram is born in ninth year. See this calculation for Seder Olam? This is what Seder Olam does. From creation to the birth of Avram Avinu is 1948. That's based on genealogies from chapters 5 and 11 in Bereshit. Do the math, it works out nicely. From the birth of Avram to the birth of Yitzchak is 100 years. How do we know that? We just read it a week and a half ago. V'Avram ben Matshana b'Vedlo Yitzchak b'no. The Exodus takes place 400 years after the birth of Yitzchak. That's based on an assumption of pre-pen of turn being 400 years from the birth of Yitzhak. It's minimum that. Got it? Therefore, Yitzhak Mitzrayim is 2448. You've all seen that date before, haven't you? According to Seder Olam, which is based on Chumash, based on Sukim, Yitzhak Mitzrayim has happened no earlier than 2448. If I assume that Yitzhak Mitzrayim happened 400 years after the birth of Yitzhak, which is the Midrashic interpretation, okay, ready for a surprise? I want you all to do the math together. Where's our whiteboard? Our whiteboard, here we go. No, that's not the whiteboard. Wrong share, stop share. Share whiteboard, here we go. I'm sorry, stop that, you know, here. Let's get back to my mouse. Okay, let's go to text box, here we go. What do we need to do? What do we have to add to, what do we have to take 3332 and add what?
2448.
Okay, and what do you get?
5780, Tav Shin Pei.
Which is what?
Shin Pei, today's year.
That's today's year. Isn't that cute? Now, what's surprising? That's the Jewish year. Now, but in 5781, well, wait till New Year's, and this will be 2021, understand? We'll be in 2021, just in January, it'll be 5781, but right now it's not for 5780. Let's get this back here. Oh, what happened here? 57. Hope that made sense, maybe? Wait. let me get back to my. If I take 333.2 plus 2448, which is Yitzhak Mitzrayim, I get 5780, which is nothing other than Jewish year.
2448, not 2248.
2448, okay, my mistake, 2448. That's how we get our Jewish year. Which means what? Which means when you write the Jewish year, what assumption are you making? You're making the assumption that what? That there's that Daryavesh is our Tachshasta, got it? That there's no gap between chapter 6 and 7, and that there's only 6 years between the end of Tanakh and Alexander the Great. Now, we'll have to see how the rabbis built this up. The midrashic work they do to prove this, it's acrobatics, it's awesome, and it's beautiful, and it's elegant. But I want to show you today that the Jewish state, that's what the Jewish state is based. That's what I just showed you now, might be beyond a shadow of a doubt, that's how it came about. It makes perfect sense, doesn't it? It makes sense that the rabbis wanted Binyan Shtarot to be a Jewish state, and they did a midrash to turn the Greek date into a Jewish state, to mash up Yitzhak Mitzrayim. To do that, they had to do a lot of midrashic acrobatics. It's worth it to turn the Greek date that everyone's using into Jewish date. Is it historical in our sense? Of course not. But it's totally logical and understandable. I'm not saying for sure it's historically true. I'm just saying there's a lot of logic why people would do that. Now, what we have to talk about next, it gets things really confusing. Once that became the accepted year by the 10th century, once this minhag to count to Briat Olam became accepted, then all the midrashim, got it, that this is based on, become Jewish history. Now, if I wanted to solve the Aguna problem, how could I solve it now? I could prove that every ketuva is wrong, right? It's possible, why? Because the year's wrong. But I can't, you know why? The rabbis are a step ahead of me, you know why? What are you writing the date? Who's a rabbi there? What do they write?
Minyan.
They do the Briat Olam, the Minyan Shanim. Got it? That's why they do that, because the rabbis knew that there wasn't the real date. But it's our convention. It's Am Yisrael accepted that as a date. It's a convention. Now, how many years has it been since? Who knows how many years have been since Briat Olam? It's irrelevant. But that's Jewish tradition. It's a beautiful tradition, isn't it? I try and explain where it came from. Now, but because of this, let's go back now, and that we have to finish up our overtime. Look what happens. Because of this, this affects art scroll and everything you learn in Cheder and everything where you go. Why? Because if there's no gap between Doresh and Achashverosh, right, then Achashverosh has to be over here between Koresh and Daryavesh. There's nowhere else to put him. I have 13 years of Megillat Esther. If after Artaxasta, as Greeks come 6 years later, I can't put Purim after Artaxasta. I can't put him before Koresh because he's a Persian king. So the only place I can put him is between Koresh and Daryavesh. But when does Megillat Esther happen? Inside gap one. It doesn't fit the outside sources in history, for sure not. But there's so many midrashim that are based on that. And what do you gain? Once I'm forced to put Achashverosh here, aren't I now? Because there's nowhere else to put him. Why does Daryavesh allow the Jews to build the Mikdash as soon as he becomes king? Because Achashverosh is the father of Daryavesh. And the daughter and the son of Esther. Of course, and Mordechai is running the show. Got that? And there's a world of Midrash, and what was the party about? The party is the 7 years of the party. There's a whole world of Midrash that's built on this. What I want to claim is, what happens? When you go to college or go to school, you'll see that the years of Seder Olam don't match outside history at all. Because again, I showed you all these years. These years, it's hard to argue with them. You find them everywhere in archaeology. Because we have Cyrus's tomb. We have the tombs of Darius and Xerxes. All the Greek historians write about them. We have lists of kings. And there's so much literature, both historical and archaeological, and all these different kings. All the wars between the Greeks and the Persians. Remember the Battle of Marathon, the Battle of Salamis. All this famous stuff. And so much literature on it. To say it's all made up, and all these things didn't happen, and this doesn't make sense that way. Now, what led to that? I think that the desire to make sure that the Greek year was a Jewish year, that override, they had a different understanding of history. Now, what happened over time, because people were not aware of all the outside history, the Midrashic interpretation of Seder Olam became Jewish history. And once I start counting and use this as a Jewish year, once that custom became, it works backwards, then all the Midrashim that turn that to the Jewish year become Jewish history. And therefore, it's a given in every history book that Achashverosh is what he called. The son of Achashverosh is Daryavesh. And he's the son of Esther also, and things like that. And the party is for the 7 years of the Beit HaMikdash and things like that. We'll get to that later on. But I want to dedicate today's year to is to show you where that's coming from. And I think there's a real logical reason why the rabbis did that. Now, what enabled that? The gap in the book of Ezra. Now, and Shir, I have to give you a much better reason why there's so many gaps in the book of Ezra. Because I have to give a thematic reason the gaps in the book of Ezra enabled the rabbis to do this, the Seder Olam interpretation. But there's going to be a better reason why there's gaps in Ezra. And the reason for the gaps in Ezra is going to be the same reason, we'll see, relate to the reason why they crunched all the years. Again, that's too complicated for now. We'll get that later on. I simply wanted to dedicate one class to what the Jewish year is. And now you ask me, what is the Jewish year? We have no idea, but if you do one calculation, it could be Mashiach's around, what do you call it? It's about a couple of decades away. So that would be really cool. Like the year 6,000 is coming up really a lot sooner. But there's tons of literature on this. I was trying to give a nice, simple, logical explanation of how this came about. Now let's start listening to the questions. Let's go back. Flood, okay. Oh, not too many questions. Oh, Shemitah and Yovel. By the way, look in the Rambam Hilchot Shemitah and Yovel. They say we have a Masorah, even though the year is this way, we have a different Masorah. Shemitah and Yovel goes by what we're holding by. We don't calculate backwards from there. Tov Shimon there. Minyan Shtarot. Minyan Shtarot is what the rabbis call the Greek year. Minyan Shtarot is the Seleucid year or the Greek year that everyone was using. And the Romans took it over. So Minyan Shtarot, that's the rabbinic name for the Greek year. Isn't 2020 not a continuous counting? No, they added days. The years have been, listen, Yoshka was born in -4, if you're talking about that. But if he had immaculate birth, he could have been 4 years before he was born is also okay. But I'm pretty sure the Greek, the year is built on, by the way, there's 2 years missing between 380. There's that 2 years between this and the rabbinic tradition, whether the temple was destroyed in 70 or 68. But that's I left all that out. I try to keep it nice and simple. I'm just trying to show you what was the logic of the year. When the popes, I'll put iPad's question. All the calendar reform is always done by churches. That's why the Council of Nicaea and in the 300s or so, when they built their calendar, very similar to the time period of Robin Schmoe making our calendar a little bit later on. But our calendar and that every religion has to set a calendar with the holidays. In fact, the early Christians were using the Jewish, needed our calendar to have Easter. You know, they got sick of us after a while and they started making their own calendar. But they needed us to celebrate Passover. We got them crucified, so we had to get these are dates. But the calendar is really interesting. Later things got mixed up with months and things like that. So they added 14 days, but I think the year count's been pretty much the same. Okay. The fact that what Yerusha is saying, the Avram in 1948, I call that Yashka Min HaTorah Minayin, meaning what's the remez that there's something about the Christian date, there's something significant about it. If you understand the joke, fine. If not, Rabbi, you get it, Rabbi, right?
Of course.
You know how the Gemara goes, Haman Min HaTorah Minayin, Yashka Min HaTorah Minayin.
I know your sense of humor quite well, but even without knowing your sense of humor, I would get that joke.
Okay.
It's not even a joke. I mean, it's true. If you believe Avraham Shemayim, it's not a joke. HaKadosh Baruch Hu arranged, Avraham Avinu in 1948. Anyways, really what you're saying, if I may, in other words, is the rabbis really had no interest in real history, which is true. And the Rambam had no interest in the issues of real history. That just wasn't a concern of the rabbis.
It wasn't their understanding of history wasn't like ours.
Correct. It wasn't historical. Just like the Midrashim are not literal, their understanding of history was not historical. It's not like, and like you said, I think your explanation is very, very beautiful why they would do it in the 1,000 years. And of course, the 480 probably isn't real either. The, what you alluded to, the 12 times 40, for the Beit Hamikdash, it's not a coincidence. If 40 is the number, obviously, of Yetziat Mitzrayim and in the desert and in Har Sinai. So it would be 40 times 12. So of course, the dates in the Torah are never literal. We, you know, the Jews weren't exactly in the desert 40 years because Moshe was 80 and 120. Well, how long it took time for the Makot? So obviously, everything's rounded. The years are symbols.
Like Rabbi Akiva. Sure. Yeah.
I'm sorry?
Like Rabbi Akiva, 40, 40, and 40.
Right. There are all those Midrashim, absolutely. Which would, by the way, if that's true, it would mean that Rabbi Akiva was learning in his 24 years when the Beit HaMikdash was destroyed. In other words, if you put those Midrashim literally, that Rabbi Akiva was, you know, knew nothing till the age of 40, and 40 to 80 he was learning, and then he became the teacher. Well, the year's 40, and he was killed in 135, Bar Kokhba revolt. So it means he was born in 15. So he's born in 15. So at 40, he's 55 years old. So he goes to yeshiva. The 24 years he leaves his wife is when the Beit HaMikdash is burning. There's something strange about that story. Rabbi Akiva is sitting and learning, and the temple is burning. Like, you can already tell the history. That doesn't sound right.
Okay.
Yeah. I don't know if you agree with me, but
I got you. That what I'm trying to explain to you, why is this important? If you go to yeshiva and take the like all these years, the idea that Bayit Sheni is 420, which is in the Gemara, is based on Seder Olam.
Right.
The 420 is based on Seder Olam. Now, if you look at outside history, look what happens to everyone says. Ask anybody, when is the first temple destroyed? 586. The second one, plus 70. Okay. And there were 7 years in between. That means the second temple was 580 some years, according to everybody. Because I'll say 420. I've seen timelines that show 420 in Hebrew and 580 in English. You follow? And I hope people won't notice the difference between them. It's such an obvious, it's just the 420 just doesn't work. It doesn't hold up to anything. 332 being Alexander the Great, every year is recorded from 332. So how are you going to fit with 332? How are you going to figure, and then plus 70, that's 402 years already from Alexander the Great. How are you going to fit 18 years all of the Persian time period? It just can't be. It just doesn't work. Now, why is that important? Because if you go to college and you see the outside history, it doesn't match Seder Olam. So if the rabbis are wrong in history, maybe they're wrong in halakha and everything. And, oh my gosh, now you have teenagers have new reasons why not to keep things. I'm trying to explain why, if I'm going to find a contradiction between rabbinic understanding of history and our historical understanding of history, there's a good reason for it. It's not because they made a mistake or they're wrong or anything. They had a different, their historical background, their understanding of history was more midrashic. And there's a really good reason why they crunched the years. Now, when we get more into the book of Ezra and Nehemiah and Haggai and Zechariah and Yeshayahu, I'm going to give even a better reason why they jump all the years. This reason is only reason number one. I'm going to give a much better reason why they crunched the years. And it'll be the reason why there's a Deuter Isaiah. Now, when you get to that'll be the Zionistic part of the course. Let me give the introduction to it because my time's up anyhow. The section goes like this. The biggest disappointment of Nevuah, and I think probably of God, is that Bayit Sheni should have been greater than Bayit Rishon. But Bayit Rishon was bad enough, Bayit Sheni should have fixed things. When Bayit Sheni didn't work out right, it's a disaster, isn't it? What else? The fallout for Bayit Sheni failing, I can understand the first time, but Bayit Sheni failing, that led to Christianity, didn't it? The failure of Bayit Sheni and all the Nevuot of Bayit Sheni. The first temple fell, the second temple. After the second temple falls and nothing's rebuilt after 100, 200 years, that leads right to Christianity, doesn't it? They believe in the same God, the same Bible. God left his people. The idea that if I go back to between the first and second temple period, the fact that, this is our topic, we're digging in the book of Ezra already, the fact that most people did not return with Ezra, and the fact that the temple could have gotten off the ground. Let me just clarify that. At the end of chapter 6, they dedicated the temple. Where is everybody? Why don't they all come back? The fact that there is no great return on Bayit Sheni. And most of the community stays in Babylonia. That's going to be the beginning of the end of Bayit Sheni before it began. And that's going to explain tons of things in Megillat Esther, or explain why we have missing years. I'll suggest a much better reason for the missing years. It wasn't just a mistake or midrashic. There was something deep behind it. And also, the rabbis are hiding something. One last hint. And don't be surprised, the book of that time period is called Hidden. What book is that? Esther, right? Remember Esther Minotaur, Minotaur, Esther, Panai? There's something hidden in the time period, and that'll explain why Dutrasea is where it is. It'll explain a lot of things, but we did enough for today. I just want to make sure. And like, the goal is not the rabbis are wrong. The goal is the rabbis are right. They had a different understanding of history. And I want to appreciate where our year comes from.
Okay, Rabbi. Yes, thank you. Okay, it just happened to say, by the way, your point about the kids, you know, when they do the history, it's really true. It's true in so many areas that, you know, if we don't teach it in a sophisticated way, kids are going to go and going to be exposed. And our approach is to expose them and to teach it. Other people have the approach, we're going to try to shield them so they never hear about the other side. But
is it insulation or inoculation? Or inoculate?
You know, it's the same thing you can say on biblical criticism, opening, all kinds of things. Yeah. This applies across the board in so many subjects. Okay, it's like you say, time is up. So we'll look forward to next week and next year on the Torah Motion Zoom channel tomorrow evening, 8:30 p.m. Mark Shapiro continuing on his correspondence with the rabbinic figures, a wide range of rabbinic figures. Then we'll meet Tuesday for Midrash and Sefer Tehillim. Wednesday we'll have a triple header. Thursday a double header. The Parsha Shir this week by Rabbi Michael Whitman from Montreal. So, and our rotating shiur, we look forward to seeing you, and have everybody be well, be healthy. Invite your friends to join us.
Happen, when they get a vaccine, what's going to happen to all the shiurim?
We're going to continue, please God. I don't know what happened to attend, right? I was just reading an article this morning about, Lisbon, that we were supposed to go to Portugal this summer. That's where we're supposed to go. The Torah Motion trips have sort of been on hiatus, to put it mildly. So there was a whole article how the mayor of Lisbon took this as a way to redesign all of Lisbon with the housing. It was a very interesting article. You have to, we can learn things. So please God, the Pfizer and Madero and all these other vaccines will actually get on the market soon, as it's not so easy to distribute them. They'll work, and please God, we'll continue learning online. Well, why not? Why not? What the Schleppi come to travel? You know what? I'll say another thing. Everybody can leave now. This is just, we're schmoozing. All the